I want to give a huge shout out to all my Patreon and channel member supporters. Thank you so much for your support, guys. It really means a lot and really helps the channel to keep growing. Hey guys, Jay! Welcome back to the channel. So guys, with the Masters of the Universe Revolution finally ending its run on Netflix, we all are now waiting on bated breath to find out if there's going to be a Season 3 for Masters of the Universe on Netflix. We just have to hold out hope that another season will be possible. But in the meantime, there are some unanswered questions that we have from the series. So much so that I might have to do an entire running series on this. There are a lot of things to be answered through both of these series, as they brought up a lot of questions, including, who is Despera? But that's a question for a much later date. Today, I wanted to ask an even bigger question. Yes, something even bigger than Despera. Guys, I wanted to find out the burning question of who is Keldor. Now, some of you might be thinking, we've seen Keldor. We've seen Keldor in so many different versions, and everybody knows who Keldor is. But do we? Let's be honest, guys. Keldor has appeared in multiple different media, all the way back in the mini-comics from the Masters of the Universe action figure line. That's where he first showed up, and then, subsequently, additional versions of Keldor came in the form of the 2000X He-Man and the Masters of the Universe series by Mike Young. There, he had a very different take on the Keldor that we thought we knew. That sort of lore led into multiple iterations of Keldor, including those in comic books, and finally, the final iteration that we've seen in the Masters of the Universe on Netflix series, in Masters of the Universe Revolution. And I wanted to take a deep dive into the origins of Keldor, and I couldn't do this alone, because Keldor's past is one shrouded in mystery, and it's hard to decipher exactly who Keldor is without asking for some help. And for one of the original origins of Keldor, the very first appearance, if you will, I had to turn to the most reliable source I could think of, Adam from Battleground Blog.
Hey guys, this is Adam from Battleground Blog. Just chiming in here to put my two cents into Mega J Retro's video on Keldor. I thought I would talk a little bit about the origins of the character in the vintage line. There's not a ton there. It's an idea that doesn't come around until the very end of the original 1980s Masters of the Universe line. And it comes in one source, the mini comic, The Search for Keldor. And that was written by Stephen Grant, artwork by Bruce Timm. And in the story, you get King Randor searching for what happened to his brother, Keldor, his long-lost brother. We're introduced to this story here. Apparently, Keldor was trying to be a master of magic. He was experimenting with it. It went beyond his control, and he was lost in some alternate dimension. But apparently, on one night per year in Eternia, the veil between dimensions is weaker, and this allows the sorceress to help Randor to use the power of the Three Towers of Eternia to try to open the veil and find out what happened to his long-lost brother, Keldor. And then in another panel, we get Skeletor is freaking out about this. He's saying they must never discover the secret of Keldor because the knowledge would destroy him. And it's over and over again in the story, it's very strongly hinted. There's some connection between Keldor and Skeletor, and they don't say it directly, but they're hitting you in the face. Yeah, Skeletor is Keldor. And there's a few times that they do that. So Skeletor and Faker kind of appear. They're in the midst of kind of appearing on the scene. And in that page, you also have the sorceress, you know, seemingly about to succeed in finding Keldor. And you sort of get this image, the shadowed image of Skeletor. And Randor is basically, oh, is this Keldor? It's very strongly hinted throughout without saying it outright, but because the series ended there was no more time to find out more, you know, exactly how Keldor had become Skeletor. Any of those details were not fleshed out in the vintage line. I should note that there's no indication that from this era that Keldor would have been a blue-skinned person. There wasn't that idea of a Gar race. In fact, the Gar thing, even though it sort of stems from 2002 with Anwat Gar and Cyclone, that wasn't really called out as a race. And I know Jukka Isakainen will have more to say about that. So if they had gone on to do Keldor, he probably, you know, would have looked more similar to Randor. Now, the writer of the story, Stephen Grant, was interviewed a couple of times, and there was one interview in particular on the old He-Man.org forums where he kind of clears up what was the thought process, why they were doing this. So
his backstory wasn't really worked out. Some sort of evil cosmic energies altered him. I think they were going for a Darth Vader thing, but it was a tack on. He also touched upon why Skeletor didn't want the heroes finding out about Keldor. The main idea was that if they found out Skeletor was Keldor, they'd be able to find out what had changed him and might find some way to reverse it. As far as how Keldor became Skeletor, Grant said, "The Nameless One had something to do with Keldor becoming Skeletor. I think he was their version of Emperor Palpatine, the great evil behind everything else." As with everything else, there was no more backstory. The Nameless One here refers to the Unnamed One, which King Hiss and the Snake Men serve, not to be confused with the Faceless One.
So that's kind of his backstory for the whole series up until this one little comic in 1987, which then is picked up in later continuities, and it continues to evolve. So that's it for the vintage story of Keldor. Take it away to the next part of the story.
Thanks a lot, Adam. I really appreciate your insight into the first appearance of Keldor in the original minicomic series. As well, I want to thank Toon Jukka for adding his voice to the He-Man.org segment, which has all but been lost because He-Man.org did actually go down a number of months ago. So I want to give a huge shout out to Toon Jukka, who helped us with this portion of the history of Keldor. Guys, please check out Battleram blog. Adam over there is doing an incredible job. He is literally keeping an archive of He-Man and the Master Universe on the page Battleram blog. Definitely give him a like and a follow. Tell him that Jay sent you. Now, returning to Toon Jukka, we find out more about Keldor's very next appearance in canon as the Mike Young series picks up where the mini-comics left off.
August 16th, 2002, the new reboot cartoon of He-Man and the Masters of the Universe by Mattel and Mike Young Productions aired on Cartoon Network. In this new version, the viewers are introduced to a blue-skinned Keldor, who attacks the Hall of Wisdom, where the governing rulers, the Council of Elders, are. The Elders had just then appointed Randor as the King of Eternia, which Keldor is unaware of as he bursts in. He fights against Captain Randor, depicting his skills as a great swordsman, and after the fight scene, he is defeated by Randor. But Keldor has a small vial containing magic-imbued liquid that he throws at Randor, only for it to be deflected back at him. Keldor is thus burned by his own magic, but he manages to escape to the Dark Hemisphere, where the good guys seal him off behind the Mystic Wall. In another flashback, we see that in the Dark Hemisphere, Keldor went to a sanctuary dedicated to Hordak, where he was able to contact the ancient warlord. Keldor says he's dying and needs help to continue his conquest of Eternia. Hordak states that there will be a price to pay, to which Keldor agrees, and Hordak uses his magic to save Keldor's life, but by turning him into Skeletor in the process. It is revealed that the price to pay is Hordak requesting Skeletor to break him free from the terrible dimension of Despondos, where Hordak's spirit ended up in his battle against King Grayskull in ancient times. As Hordak mortally wounded King Grayskull, and his spirit is being pulled through the portal into Despondos, Hordak screams that he shall return. And in the original script, his full sentence was, "I shall return, Grayskull, I will find the perfect vessel, and by their hand shall regain power." These nuggets of information you can find in the unofficial 2002 He-Man cartoon guide, which includes other trivia and behind-the-scenes research, as well as synopsis and reviews on all episodes. So that means Hordak had been searching for thousands and thousands of years for someone, until Keldor came along. In the comics by MV Creations, we learn that Hordak sent the young Keldor into the past to retrieve the stave from Lord of Salacia, or Havokstaff as most fans know it, one of the keys to help attempt Hordak to break free from Despondos. The comics also showcased how Keldor recruited some of his henchmen in the Icons of Evil miniseries. But in the modern times, Skeletor betrayed Hordak and didn't go through with the plan, and instead destroyed Hordak's sanctuary. As Season 2 focused more and more on the new Snakemen threat, Skeletor actively wasn't seen in the final episodes. In the animated series, the creators never had a proper chance to confirm on screen that Keldor is the half-brother of Randor. One hint occurs in the episode The Last Stand, where Prince Adam tries to stop Skeletor from entering Grayskull, and he manages to grab his staff, to which Skeletor replies with, "It's not nice to take what rightfully belongs to others, but then again, like father, like son." The reveal came in a 2005 Q&A over at the Hema.org forums with producer Ian Richter, confirming that Randor and Skeletor are brothers. "This was always the plan. They have different mothers, but the same father. I was disappointed we never got to finally do this." Which gives Randor and Keldor a history to explore. Their father is Captain Miro, who never was a king in the reboot series, so there was no rightful heir or bloodline.
Eternia really never had a king. It was ruled by the elders, who were like, you know, who were these sages, these wise people. And only when they had to coalesce and become this crystal, and Eternia lost those people to give them the wisdom, then they decided to choose a king, and they chose Randor. That's how Randor became king. He was merely a captain in the guard, in the royal guard, or in the guard at the time.
The Council of Elders were the rulers, which is why in Randor's case, he was more than surprised to all of a sudden be given that title and responsibility. And in Keldor's case, his plans for conquest are that of a power-hungry madman. The writers and producer of the 2002 series revealed in a panel at PowerCon how they had seen the interview with the minicomic writer.
"Having the message boards even before we started development was really, really interesting. It was kind of a new thing. And the idea to make Skeletor Keldor was directly from the boards. So when I discovered that that was something that was He-Man lore, I thought, what if we actually made that come true? And so that, the message boards and the fan community had a huge influence on this show."
The design of Keldor went through many stages, and in some he's depicted with a receding hairline, or he's depicted as older evil bastard, until they evolved into the more handsome look for the character. So there you have it. Thank you once again to Mega J for inviting me to take part in this. I hope you enjoyed the video. You can check out my channel, Toon Jukka, for more behind the scenes videos, origins, and histories about He-Man and She-Ra.
Thanks for that wonderful insight, Jukka. Guys, Toon Jukka is a wonderful resource for He-Man and the Master Universe, particularly the 2002 cartoon by Mike Young. As a matter of fact, I have a link in the description below where you can check out his book, He-Man and the Master Universe, an unofficial guide to the 2002 cartoon by Jukka Isakainen. And now, we should take a look at one of the more interesting versions of Keldor depicted in the comic books. And for that, I'll need the help of my good friend Bobby from A Toy Kind of Mood on YouTube.
Okay, so when Mega J asked me to do this, I'm like, okay, great. And they're like, I don't have those books anymore. This is the quick story on He-Skeletor, the most powerful Keldor in the universe. This bad boy. Look, A Toy Kind of Mood, it's got to have something to go back to toys, right? So Mattel Creations did this. It was fantastic. Panthor with the Battle Cat gear. Where to begin? Let's jump into the beginning. All right, so this Keldor that we're discussing in this Keldor from completely different Eternia, one where King Randor is Randoth, and as we see here, You do have an anti-Eternia He-Man, there we go, the all black and red. And his whole purpose is trying to collect as many power swords as possible. Now, basically the way that this issue starts off is, once again, like every other universe, Skeletor is saying that he wants the power of Grayskull. He-Man and Sorcerer go, okay, fine, we'll go find him again. Status quo, he gets out there, finds the Havoc Staff, rammed through Skeletor's chest, and then anti-Eternia He-Man kills He-Man, therefore, as we can see in the top corner, taking the power away from the Sorceress. And Grayskull collapsing. Now, we do go to the 80s filmation, which they call him the corniest He-Man, but also the one that's always right. And he's trying to figure out, you know, how to defeat this He-Man. This Keldor is someone who is, he hasn't been subjected to the whims of Hordak, and he is one where he's still trying to find his place. We see him talking to He-Man here, and like every He-Man knows it, Keldor eventually becomes, Skeletor becomes evil, but this Keldor is seeing a lot of stuff in his life that might keep him from changing into Skeletor. The Keldor that we see is from this universe. He does get the movie, Dolph Lundgren He-Man, cartoon He-Man, I don't know, which I didn't really know which one that was from. And this is from one of the multiverses where pretty much every universe they go to, Skeletor is a bad guy. Adam loses his sword for a bit, and we do see Keldor fighting anti-Eternia He-Man. He keeps up with him. I do love the fact that the filmation, Skeletor is kind of cackling, but they have the theme song playing, you know, whenever something big is about to happen. And of course, Keldor gets half his face burned off, revealing that, you know, he could become Skeletor. We go to another multiverse where this is the early 80s mini comics, which, let's be real here, I've got, my wife got me quite a few of them for Christmas, which was awesome. But once again, like, every story is He-Man fighting Skeletor. The old school art in this, we see Keldor trying to speak with that He-Man, but we just saw every He-Man only knows one thing, that Skeletor is a bad guy. Like, this is a bad person. But this Keldor is still trying to figure out his way in life. The movie He-Man is able to say, nope, this guy's different, trust me. He gets switched over to the anti-Eternia universe, where everyone is black and red, which it's a vibe. When Keldor finally faces off against anti-Eternia He-Man, you have a slew of He-Man using the power source to draw in the evil that is the anti-Eternia, and the last one to do it. This is where it kind of gets a little different. You realize that Keldor was, on his universe, going to become He-Man, not Skeletor. So he says, I can have the power. You know, kind of a little politeness there, right? We see that he has defeated the anti-Eternia, and we realize that it was kind of like a giant plague created by an even weaker Adam that just couldn't resist the power. Every iteration of Prince Adam has been somewhat of a... he's always been in kind of a shape, but this one was actually really weak. The power was too enticing, right? So we see that he apologizes, dies, and, you know, last we see is Keldor going back to graffiti, you know, the palaces of his Eternia. We never get a definitive saying of which Eternia this is. It just, every issue when we got a new He-Man was, this Eternia is the heart of its universe. So each Eternia was the heart of that multiverse. So this was a 6-issue book written by Tim Seeley, Hackslash, with artists Dan Fraga, Richard Friend, Matt Yackey, and variant cover artist Inyuk Lee. To get all these different universes. I remember being a really, really fun read. And if you can find this Skeletor, it's fantastic. Get it. Yeah. And so with that, you know, I will see you in the twilight. Peace.
Thanks for those wonderful insights, Bobby. Guys, you can check out more of Bobby on A Toy Kind of Mood on YouTube. I'll have a link in the description below where you can check out his channel. Definitely give him a like or follow. Tell him that Jay sent you. And now we're going to take a closer look at a completely different version of Keldor in the Netflix edition of He-Man and the Master Universe, presented by yours truly. The Netflix 3D animated He-Man and the Master Universe television series has given us a brand new take on the world of Eternia. This alternate universe presents Prince Adam as an orphan who was adopted by the Tiger Tribe. Far away from the palace life we are familiar with in all other versions of Master of the Universe, and totally unaware of his destiny as a protector of the power of Grayskull. In this version of events, Keldor is revealed as emerging from a stasis pod deep within Snake Mountain. His appearance is that of a royal, but his left hand has been completely dissolved, leaving only a skeletal hand behind. Keldor is presented to us as an arrogant, self-centered, egotistical megalomaniac whose only goal is the Sword of Grayskull. After reuniting with his companions Evelyn and Kronos, each of them formerly loyal to the royal family of Eternia, Keldor learns that his nephew and heir to the throne, Prince Adam, is alive and has already obtained the Sword of Greyskull. After learning this, Keldor reunites with Adam, coming to his rescue, demonstrating his power in wielding chaos magic. After a brief reunion, where Keldor learns that Adam actually has amnesia.
You don't remember what happened.
I don't remember anything before the jungle.
Keldor turns on his nephew.
So, you can't change them?
Taking the Sword of Power and attempting to bury Adam and his friends alive. Keldor then takes the Sword of Power back to Castle Greyskull, where he attempts to heal himself of the curse which was placed upon him by his own selfish choices. We learn through a vision of the past that Keldor had betrayed his brother Randor, the ruler of Eternos, and taking Prince Adam captive to try and claim the power of Greyskull for himself.
Release this castle's power to me instead of my brother, and you have yourself a deal, sorceress.
Ghosts, Crass. Just echoes of the past. My past.
Proper use of the power requires selection of a totem from mastery of one's true self. Choose wisely.
After choosing poorly which type of power he desired, Keldor tried forcing the Sorcerer of Greyskull to heal him. After she refused, Keldor's rage got the better of him, and he attempted to kill the sorceress, only to have a young Prince Adam claim the Sword of Greyskull, using it to deflect Keldor's blast to save the sorceress. Proving that Adam was the true protector of the power, and the complete opposite of Keldor. After learning the truth of his past, Adam once again claims the sword to become He-Man once again. After defeating Keldor, Evelyn, and Kronos in battle, an enraged Keldor plunges his scepter into the power of Greyskull to claim the power of Havoc completely. Only to be driven mad by the power, and taking his allies with him, falling into the chasm. We later discover that the trio had been transported back to Snake Mountain, where it was revealed that Keldor had absorbed the power of chaos completely. And like Adam, whose form had been transformed by the power of Greyskull, chaos had transformed Keldor into the evil Skeletor. Skeletor and He-Man would do battle many times during the series, but finally, in the last episode of Season 3, spoilers ahead, Skeletor is defeated and his Havoc Staff lost to parts unknown. He-Man then uses the power of Greyskull to return Skeletor back into Prince Keldor. Returning him to Eternos, where he is imprisoned for his crimes.
You'll have an eternity to contemplate that in the dungeons.
This Keldor is the most sinister version that we've ever seen thus far. He literally is kidnapping his own nephew to try and claim the power of Greyskull, and is absolutely arrogant in his own self-worth. When he cannot claim the power of Greyskull, which he had perceived to be his very own, he turns on the sorceress who had offered him the power of choice, and in doing so, truly revealed who the hero of Greyskull really was. This again enrages Keldor, and he turns on his nephew, trying to kill him. And thus, Keldor's true nature is revealed, where he is only interested in his own self-worth and is completely devoid of any sort of empathy for anyone else around him. It remains to be seen if we'll be seeing any more of Keldor, as Season 3 basically left us off with a cliffhanger, and it doesn't seem to be any news that Season 4 will be renewed anytime soon. But I do have to say that this version of Keldor is one of the most interesting that we've seen thus far in the Masters universe. And now, I'd like to invite Michael of Toy Habits to talk about the latest edition of Keldor in Masters Universe Revolution.
The Masters of the Universe Revolution Netflix series features some heavy-hitting voice actors, one of them being William Shatner, best known for his portrayal of Captain Kirk in the Star Trek television series. Announced at San Diego Comic-Con back in July 2023, Shatner was revealed as the first new actor confirmed for the continuation of the Masters of the Universe Revelation Netflix series. Leading up to the debut of Masters of the Universe Revolution, a shroud of mystery was building up as to who Shatner would be lending his voice to for the series. The casting of Keldor was kept under wraps so much so that there was a combined effort by the producers of Revolution and Mattel to keep the name of Shatner's character hidden until after the debut of the series, which was back on January 25th, 2024. We saw this effort played out on Instagram as the MOTU box art illustration team stopped short of revealing the cross-sell of the Masterverse Wave 12 figure assortment, which would reveal the fourth character. As we were determined to figure out who Shatner was voicing, we looked for clues on the internet. It was just by skill, or maybe sheer luck, that we happened to be surfing on an online retailer's website where the name of the fourth figure was accidentally revealed and then removed the following day. This was the mistake we needed that led us to speculate that William Shatner would indeed be voicing Keldor. As we learned from watching the Masters of the Universe Revolution series, there were Easter eggs that referenced the Filmation He-Man and the Masters of the Universe and She-Ra and the Princess of Power cartoon series and the Masters of the Universe movie from 1987. As we watched the series unfold, a Star Trek Easter egg was referenced in Episode 3, More Things in Heaven Than Eternia. Keldor's line, "I'm laughing at the superior intellect," is from Star Trek The Wrath of Khan, where it's spoken by James Kirk to taunt his nemesis, Khan. Once the Masters of the Universe Revolution series aired on January 25th, 2024, William Shatner took to Twitter to confirm that he was very happy to join the MOTUverse as Keldor, which he refers to the character as an amazingly charming, handsome, and misunderstood uncle of Prince Adam and brother to King Randor. He brilliantly voiced the character as his vocal tones complemented the sinister yet believable demeanor of Keldor.
Thank you, Michael, for that in-depth look at Keldor from Master Universe Revolution. Guys, be sure to check out ToyHabits.com for all the latest news and reviews as they happen. Give them a like and a follow. Tell them that Jay sent you. Guys, this has been an incredible look at every rendition of Keldor that has appeared in different types of media. I want to thank all of my friends who helped to make this possible. Adam from Battle Ram Blog, Jukka from Toon Jukka, Bobby from A Toy Kind of Mood, and of course, Michael from Toy Habits. I will have links in the description below where you can follow each and every one of these wonderful creators on all of their platforms. I really appreciate all their help. I couldn't have done it without them. Guys, let me know in the comment section below, what were your thoughts about Keldor and his history throughout the ages? It cannot be denied that Keldor is definitely one of the most interesting characters in the Masters of the Universe. His mysterious nature all the way back in the toy line of 1980s and his appearance finally in the Masters of the Universe Revolution really have made him into the most interesting character, both in the history of the character and, of course, where he might be going in the future. Let me know in the comment section below, guys, which Keldor was your favorite, if you even have one. Which Keldor did you think was the most compelling or the most sinister, and which Keldor do you believe will someday return to wreak havoc upon Eternia once more? This was an example of a deep dive retrospective, which I've been looking into for quite some time, and I want to know from you guys if you enjoy this type of content, because if you do, I would love to do additional versions and deep dives into different characters in both Master Universe, G.I. Joe, Thundercats, and of course, Transformers. Let me know those comments in the comment section below, guys. If you enjoyed this episode, please do leave me a like. It really does help me out. And if you're in the position to help the channel, please consider checking out my Patreon page. It's Mega J Retro on Patreon. Guys, the patrons and channel members of this channel help me make wonderful episodes every single week, and I couldn't do it without them. They are the best. Thank you so much for your support, everybody. It really means the world to me. I hope you're all doing well, staying safe. And as always, everybody, thank you very much for watching. Good journey, everybody. Geek proud.